us when we call on that great name. Jesus, 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 oh precious Jesus, Jesus, we have the victory, we have the victory. Come on, speed up. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, say it with me. Say I will have to leave. Oh, tell me who can stand before us when we call on that great name.
Call me Jesus,
Jesus,
come on.
Jesus, precious Jesus, we have a victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Satan will have to flee.
In the name of Jesus,
in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Satan will have to flee.
Oh,
oh, tell me who can stand before us when we call on that great name. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, we have the victory. We have the victory.
One more time, we have the victory.
We have the victory.
Come on, let's put our hands together. Father, we thank you for this day. You've been so good to us. You've spared us. And even now we gather before your presence. I pray, Lord, let this word come through with clarity and understanding. Father, we as the listeners, Lord, let this word be a benefit to our lives. Help us to apply this word. Help us to live in this word and abide in this word. And let us to hide in this word. We thank you, we praise you, glorify you. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for being here today. And today, I believe, we have a special, special message for everyone that's sitting here. And we're going to keep our bears nice and quiet as much as we can during the service. All right? And we've been talking about some things these last couple of weeks, and there have been things that I think are very critical for our existence as Christians. One of the things that's extremely real is that you've got an adversary. You've got an enemy that desires to devour you. He desires to destroy you. He desires for you to partake in his inheritance, and his inheritance is hell. His inheritance is everlasting destruction and not everlasting life. And we talked about what can we do because we got an enemy. How do you deal with an enemy? What weapons are available to deal with a spiritual enemy? Because in a spiritual war, you'll find that a gun or knife, it won't be effective against Satan. What weapons do we have to deal with the attacks of the enemy? Because he's coming to not only kill, steal, but then he wants to destroy everything that you ever represented or you ever established in your life. He wants to destroy you, your children, and every generation. So how can we stand against such a formidable enemy? How can we stand? We talked about the weapons of God. God gives us weapons. Plural and not single. In other words, he gives us more than one thing to use to fight against the devil. And what he does, we understand that there are two positions that you can be in. We talked about boxing, and that a boxer can attack but he's also ready to defend. And we discussed that there's various ways that we can implement attack. We talked about resisting the devil. We talked about opposing him, going against everything that he represents. We talked about if we live right, we give a black eye to Satan. Amen. That if we learn how to obey the principles of God, then we'll be victorious. In other words, we'll let hell know where we're standing. And our lives will prove to be representative. Our lives will go in line with the principles of Jesus Christ as he walked and as he lived his life. So we talked about attacking. We talked about protecting. We also talked about truth. What is truth? Everybody has a perspective of what they think truth is. Some people think it's just simply based upon what they've learned in a university. Some people think it's based upon the ideals of society, but there is an ultimate truth. And that ultimate truth is found in recognizing that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Yes.
I want you to know that this morning, that when Jesus came, all of the blinders came off. God was no longer hiding anything, but he completely revealed himself in Jesus. And so that is the ultimate truth. And in every day of our lives, every day that we live, every day that we go out to school or to work or wherever we're going, we have the responsibility to stand as his disciples. It's our responsibility. We are his voice. We are his children. We are his people. And so that places a burden of responsibility for us to live for him and to listen to his word. And last week we talked about the breastplate. We talked about that the breastplate of truth is more than bulletproof. And that, yes, there are bulletproof vests that you can wear in this world that have Kevlar. And there's a layering of material. And it may or may not be effective. But I gave you something last week regarding the breastplate that not only is good for this world, but it's good for the world to come. And that breastplate is the righteousness that we have through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, we are responsible for living for him. But I want you to know that my relationship is not based upon anything that I could have done to achieve the gift that he's given me through his son. And that the righteousness that I have, my righteousness, this is filthy rags. My righteousness is nothing, but my righteousness is based upon the work that Jesus did at Calvary when he set me free from every chain of Satan, when he set me free from hell, when he set me free from myself.
That's right. Yes.
The righteousness of God through the Lord Jesus Christ. And so today we're going to talk a little bit further. Ephesians, the 6th chapter, it's in your notes. The 6th chapter, the 14th through the 15th verse. Ephesians, the 6th chapter, 14th through the 15th verse. Here begins the reading of God's holy word. Stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Today I want to talk about, what are you doing with those feet? What are you doing with those feet? Now, When I was a little boy, and even a teenager, I was very peculiar about what I wanted to wear on my feet. All right. And back then it was Fila and Puma and Adidas. I had to make sure I had the right thing on my feet. Mm-hmm. Now, as an adult, providing for children going to work every day, I don't care whether it's Walmart or wherever it is, as long as I've got something on my feet. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
So I'm not as particular as I was back then as I am now, because there are a lot of things that have changed. But what you'll discover is that what you wear on your feet determines what activity that you're participating in. In other words, if I've got to go to some fancy occasion or come to church, I'm gonna wear possibly my dress shoes. Or I could wear heels. I would wear heels, but you ladies will wear heels, all right? Or if it's a snowstorm outside, I'm probably gonna put on a pair of boots, all right? If I'm going to work in a construction environment, I'm going to wear some steel-toe boots, all right? So basically, what I'm doing is determined by what footwear that I choose. And so we got to make sure that we choose the right footwear in the natural. Is that correct?
Right.
Because you don't want to go out here and run on a treadmill and you've got boots on your feet, all right? Mm. You're going to do yourself some damage and some harm. And in the same way, if that is important here, why is that not important spiritually over there? And that we have to consider what we're putting on our spiritual feet. Now, when I start talking about my spiritual feet, I'm not talking about my natural feet. But in this text today, it talks about allowing your feet to be shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. This is talking about putting something on your spiritual feet. But what are my spiritual feet? What does that mean, putting something on the feet? It surely is not talking about something natural or something physical. But the feet represent your humility. The feet represents your obedience. The feet represent your dedication. Your feet are symbolic of what you give yourself and your worship to. That's what your feet are representative of. Your feet are worship tools. Your feet, that represents your duty and your obedience. Your feet, they ultimately represent discipleship. Am I a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ? And that our feet, they must be shod. Shod means that not only putting it on, not only making sure that it fits, you know, like when you go out and buy a pair of shoes, you know, you don't get a size 7 and your foot is size 9, right? You're gonna have some problems down the road, all right? But you've gotta make sure that it fits properly. That not only what that means here, this means that not only it fits, but it means that I'm chained or I'm bound to this thing. You understand what I'm saying? That my feet are shod to the preparation. The preparation is the foundation. The foundation of the gospel. The gospel. It is the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it is a news of deliverance. And this news brings peace. I don't care what kind of storms are blowing and raging in your life. This gospel will bring peace. Peace to every storm. It'll bring right to every wrong. This gospel will make a change. It'll make a difference. And so my feet being shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, it simply means that my humility, my obedience is not only fitted, but it's tied, it's chained, it's bound to the foundation of the news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it gives me the ultimate peace.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So that's what it's talking about this morning in our text. And so you'll see that in your notes, 1, 2, 3, and 4, study that in your own personal time, but that gives you an idea of a symbolism that's used in this text. That you can never, ever have peace without the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can never have true peace without the sacrifice that Jesus made. And so now we're going to talk about the biblical mention of the location of fear. And there's several things. That's all right. Let the baby cry. You'll see several things that are mentioned regarding the location of fear. If you get the song for me, 1 Corinthians 15, 25 to 26. We're on the second page of your notes. And we're going to go down looking at the biblical mention of the location of the feet. All right? Because we're talking about what are you doing with those feet. I'm going to give you some biblical examples of what was being done regarding the location of feet. All right? All things under his feet. 1 Corinthians 15, 25 to 26. What does it say, ma'am? Read it nice and loud.
It reads, "For Christ must reign until he humbly, all his enemies beneath his feet. And the last enemy to be destroyed is death."
The last enemy to be destroyed will be death. Death has already been defeated. When Jesus died, he took on hell, death, and the grave. And hell has never been the same. But death is still lurking around. But I want you to know that one day death will be destroyed. One day sorrow will be ended. One day we'll have peace with God forever and ever and ever. Hallelujah. Mm. And here we see, number two, anointed the feet. Here, number three, behold my hands and my feet. Mm. That Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he does not hide his wounds. So many of us are hiding our wounds and our pain. We're suffering. But Jesus revealed his wounds. He said, "Look at my hands. Look at my feet." He revealed himself to his disciples. And today, if you want to get your healing, there has to be a revealing. You've got to open yourself up. That's some stuff that's too heavy for us to carry. You need help burning the load. So Jesus says, "Behold my hands and my feet." Get Romans for me, 10 and 15. We're going to talk about beautiful feet. And these are beautiful feet. I don't care if you got corns or whatever you got going on with your toes. These are beautiful feet. I'm going to tell you how to have beautiful feet this morning. All right? And you don't need to get a callus kit. I'm gonna tell you how to have beautiful, beautiful feet according to the word of God. What does that say for me? Romans 10 and 15. What does it say?
It reads, "And how shall they preach except they be sent?"
All right.
"As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them."
How beautiful are the feet? We talked about beauty, being obedient, being in the right place with God.
Yes.
I'm not in the wrong place, but I'm in the right place. Come on, go back and read it again. Come on, read it.
"And how shall they preach except they be sent?"
How can they preach except they be sent? God has sent his word. Come on, read it.
"As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things."
Every day that you go out, you're preaching something. Every day you're making a statement about yourself. What are you saying about your Savior? Hallelujah. What are you demonstrating about him? What is your life saying to your friends? What do others see and think about you? Do they see the beautifulness of the sacrifice that he made on Calvary? Come on, read it. Keep reading it.
But they have not obeyed the gospel.
All right. Now go to Romans 16 and 20. We want to talk about bruising Satan under your feet. Romans 16 and 20. What does that say? Now, we're talking about how to crush Satan. And the only way you can crush Satan is through your obedience and respect to God. That's how you're going to crush Satan. And read the text. What does it say?
The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your